بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
كما يحبه الله ويرضى. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. It makes the brothers happy at Dar al-Hadith to present this translation of Sheikh Muhammad Aman ibn Ali al-Jami'. May Allah have mercy upon Sheikh and put this in the scales of good. And the subject of this will be, this is our Aqidah.
ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم. ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء. واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. أما بعد، فإننا نفتتح في هذه الليلة المباركة إن شاء الله، ليلة الجمعة الموافقة 23 من شهر ربيع الأول لعام 1411، نفتتح درسا في العقيدة الإسلامية على منهج الأنبياء عليهم الصلاة والسلام الذي سار عليه سلفنا الصالح. مادة العقيدة تسمى توحيدا وتسمى عقيدة. العقيدة لها معنى لغوي ومعنى اصطلاحي الذي اصطلح عليه المسلمون الأولون بعد أن عرفت هذه المادة منفصلة ومستقلة، بينما كانت تدرس في كتاب الله تعالى وفي سنة رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام. أريد أن أقول إن سلفنا الصالح ليست لديهم كتب تسمى كتب العقيدة أو كتب التوحيد، بل كانوا يأخذون توحيدهم وعقيدتهم من كتاب الله مشروعا بسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولكن السلف الذين حضروا زمن الأهواء وزمن الفتن بعد أن نشأ علم الكلام اضطروا اضطرارا أن يؤلفوا كتبا في العقيدة وفي التوحيد، وهي عبارة عن الدفاع ضد هجوم علماء الكلام من الفلاسفة وعلماء المنطق اليونانيين. وصفت العقيدة بعد ذلك باسم العقيدة مادة علمية مستقلة تسمى العقيدة وتسمى التوحيد.
بسم الله. Surely we open in this blessed night, the night of Jumu'ah, which coincides with the 23rd of Rabi al-Awwal, the year 1410. We begin this dars in Aqidah al-Islamiyyah upon the manhaj of the Anbiya. May the salams of Allah and the blessings be upon them, in which our salaf were upon. The content of al-Aqidah both is called al-Tawheed and al-Aqidah. Al-Aqidah both has a lughawi meaning and a istilahi meaning. Meaning, lughawi is linguistic and istilahi is legislative. So the first meaning, the first Muslims were the one that made the istilahi meaning. This meaning, after being known separately by itself, was studied in the book of Allah Ta'ala and the Sunnah of his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to say, surely the Salaf didn't have any books called books of al-Aqidah and al-Tawheed. Nevertheless, they used to take the Aqidah and al-Tawheed from the book of Allah, legislated by the Sunnah of his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Salaf, those that were during the time of desires and fitting, after the start of ilm al-kalam, those people who rationalize things, or rationalize everything without any evidence, they were forced to write books of aqidah and tawheed as a consideration to refute the people of kalam from the people of Greek philosophy. Then al-aqidah came to be known as al-aqidah with a separate name, al-aqidah, and also it was called al-tawheed.
وأما المعنى اللغوي العقيدة مأخوذة من العبد. العبد هو الربط والتوثيق. يستعمل العبد أول ما يستعمل في الأمور الحسية كعبد الحبال والخيوط، ثم استعمل في الأمور المعنوية كعبد النكاح وعقد البيع وعقود العهود وغير ذلك. العبد كما قلنا ضد الحل، هذا هو المعنى اللغوي. والمعنى الاصطلاحي أخذ من هذا المعنى بمعنى إن العقيدة هي التصميم الجازم الذي لا يتطرق إليه شك في المطالب الإلهية وفي النبوات والأمور الغيبية. المراد بالمطالب الإلهية ما يتعلق بالرب سبحانه وتعالى بذاته وأسمائه وأفعاله، يشمل التوحيد العلمي الخبري والتوحيد توحيد القصد والطلب والعمل. كل ذلك من المطالب الإلهية. ويدخل في المطالب الإلهية الإيمان بالملائكة، والمراد بالنبوات الإيمان بنبوة الأنبياء وتصديقهم والإيمان بمعجزاتهم. ثم الأمور الغيبية كالبعث بعد الموت وما يتبع ذلك حتى يدخل العباد إحدى الدارين، الجنة أو النار، أو حتى يدخل بعضهم الجنة وبعضهم النار. هذا يسمى من الأمور الغيبية. العقيدة تشمل كل هذا، وهناك جزئيات سوف نتعرض لها أثناء الدرس. وهذه العقيدة تسمى توحيدا باعتبار آخر وبعبارة أخرى. التوحيد عندنا يخالف التوحيد عند غيرنا، لأننا كما قلنا منهج السلف، ومنهج السلف هو منهج الأنبياء. لذلك نحن نقسم التوحيد إلى ثلاثة أقسام. توحيد الله تعالى بأفعال نفسه، لأن نعتقد بأن الله وحده هو الخالق الرازق المعطي المانع النافع الضار مدبر الأمور الذي يدبر الأمر من السماء إلى الأرض. هذا المعنى يسمى توحيد الربوبية، إفراد الله تعالى بأفعال نفسه يسمى توحيد الربوبية. وأما إفراد الله تعالى بأفعال عباده بالدعاء بالاستغاثة بالذبح والنذر والخضوع والتذلل والصلاة والصيام وغير ذلك، هذا يسمى توحيد العبادة. وأما إفراد الله تعالى في أسمائه وصفاته لأن نثبت له جميع صفات الرب سبحانه وتعالى التي أثبتها لنفسه أو أثبتها له رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، هذا يسمى توحيد الأسماء والصفات. ومعنى التوحيد هنا بأنه لا يشارك الله أحد من خلقه في حقائق صفاته وحقائق أسمائه وأفعاله، وإن كان قد يحصل الاشتراك اللفظي بين الخالق وبين المخلوق في بعض الصفات والأسماء.
الشيخ سألس for the لغوي meaning, the linguistic meaning. العقيدة was taken from the word العقد, which means to tie something or something firm, strong. العقد was firstly used in أمور الحسية, like عقد الحبال, which is the tying of the ropes, عقد الخيوط, which is the tying of threads. Then it was used in أمور المعنوية, the unperceived affairs, which you actually don't see. For instance, like عقد النكاح, عقد البيع, عقود العهود, the marriage contract, the contract for business transaction, buying, contracts for some sort of trust. And other than that, an عقد is the opposite of حل, which means to loosen. The meaning اصطلاحا here was taken from that meaning. Al-Aqidah is Tasmim al-Jazim, that has no shak in the era of Ilahiyya and Nubuwat, also in the era of Umul al-Ghaybiyya, which are those unseen affairs. And what is meant by in those areas of Ilahiyya is anything which is connected to Allah, His essence, His names, and His actions, which consist of Tawheed علمي الخبري and توحيد القصدي and طلب عن عمل. He says here, and belief in the angels enters into توحيد إلهية. He says that enters into the area of توحيد إلهية. And what is meant by نبوات is belief in the prophets, the Anbiya. He said also, and seeing or believing that what they brought was truth, was the truth, and that they are truthful. And Iman, belief in their miracles. Then the fear of the unseen, like being resurrected after death. And what's from that until the worshippers enter into the two places, Al Jannah wa An-Nar, the fire, the paradise or the fire, or until some of them enter into Al Jannah, the paradise, and some of them enter into the Nar, the fire. He said this is named or called the fears of the unseen. Al Aqidah encompasses all of these things, and there are different segments of that which we will go over that during the dars, during this lesson right here. And this aqidah is named al-tawheed also, with another consideration. Our tawheed is different for, or goes against the tawheed of those other than us, because like we said, we follow the manhaj of the salaf, and the manhaj of the salaf is the manhaj of the anbiya. Because of that, we divided tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into three parts. Tawheed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his actions, that we believe that Allah alone is the creator and sustainer, and he is the one that benefits you, he is the one that gives that gives the prevention, or he's the one that benefits the one that has some sort of distress, and he's the one that follows up all of the affairs. He said he's the one that follows up the affairs from the heavens to the earth. The new Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the Tawheed of his Lordship, singling out Allah alone in his actions, is called Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, and singling Allah alone with the actions of his worshippers, with dua, with istighatha, with sradwan, in nazar, in khudu', in tadallul, with salat, and fasting, and other than that, that is called Tawheed al-Ibadah. As for singling Allah with his names and his attributes, that is to establish his descriptions or names which he has established for himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, or established by his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. This is called Tawheed al-Asma'i wa sifat. And the meaning of Tawheed is that no one from Allah's creation shares with him in the reality of his descriptions, his names, or his actions. Even if there's some sharing in the actual names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not the sharing in the actuality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is called love thee only.
سيأتي توضيح ذلك في صلب الدرس إن شاء الله. هكذا قسم التوحيد ولسائل أن يسأل من أين لنا هذا التقسيم وما دليل هذا التقسيم. الجواب: دليل هذا التقسيم يسمى الاستقراء. ومعنى الاستقراء: تتبعنا نصوص الكتاب والسنة فوجدناها بالنسبة للمطالب الإلهية تنقسم هذه الأقسام الثلاثة: نصوص تدعو العباد لأن يوحدوا الله ولا يشركوا به شيئا، والنصوص التي تأتي في هذا المعنى يؤخذ منها توحيد سميناه توحيد العبادة، ونصوص تخبر بأن الله وحده هو خالق كل شيء، وهو مدبر الأمور، وهو المعطي المانع، وهو النافع الضار. ما كان من هذا القبيل يسمى توحيد الربوبية. وهناك نصوص تصف الله بأنه سميع عليم، وأنه سميع بصير، عزيز حكيم، وغير ذلك من الأسماء والصفات. هذا النوع يسمى توحيد الأسماء والصفات. إذن لم نخرج من الكتاب والسنة في تقسيمنا التوحيد إلى ثلاثة أقسام. لذلك لا يرد قول المعترض بأن تقسيم التوحيد إلى ثلاثة أقسام تقسيم جديد لا أصل له. الجواب ما سمعت: إن هذا التقسيم تقسيم استقرائي، والدليل الاستقرائي مسلم به عند أهل العلم والمعرفة، وأكثر من يبحث في هذا النوع من الدليل علماء الأصول. هكذا يتضح سر تقسيم التوحيد إلى ثلاثة أقسام. إذا عرفنا معنى التوحيد ومعنى العقيدة، ما هو الهدف من دراسة العقيدة؟ وما هو الهدف من دراسة التوحيد؟ الهدف من ذلك معرفة العبد ربه وخالقه وولي نعمته. بما يعرف العبد ربه؟ هل يراه؟ فالله سبحانه وتعالى لا يرى في هذه الدنيا، في هذه الدار لا يرى، بمعنى ان الرؤيا غير مستحيلة ولكنها غير واقعة، لم تقع ولن تقع. لأن القوة البشرية لا تثبت أمام تجلي الرب سبحانه وتعالى في هذه الدار، هكذا أراد الله. لذلك لما طلب موسى أن يرى ربه علق الله تلك الرؤية على أن ينظر إلى الجبل، فإن استقر مكانه ولم يتدكدك سوف يرى، وإن لم يثبت الجبل فعدم ثبوت موسى من باب أولى، ولم يثبت الجبل أمام التجلي. من هنا تبين لموسى وإن كانت الرؤيا غير مستحيلة وجائزة عقلا وشرعا، ولكنها غير واقعة في هذه الدنيا لعارض، وذلك العارض ضعف القوة البشرية في هذه الدار، واستسلم موسى لذلك.
Like his power, his will, his hearing, his sight, his knowledge, and other than that. But the reality is different. Clarification will be made at the end of the Dars, inshallah ta'ala. This is the way Tawheed was divided. And it's for the questioner to ask, where did we get to these divisions? And what is the dalil for these divisions? The answer, the evidence of this division is called al-istiqra. The meaning of al-istiqra is that we have followed up the evidences of the Qur'an and the Sunnah, and we have found regarding Al-Ilahiyya is broken down into these three sections. Evidences that cause the worshipper to worship Allah and do not associate any partners with Him. And the evidences which comes with the meaning is taken from it. We call it Tawheed Al-Ibadah, and the evidences which inform that Allah is one, the only, He's the creator of everything. He is the one who disposes of the affairs. He is the giver of prevention. He is the benefactor to the one in difficulty or distress. And these evidences that describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the all-hearing, and the all-hearing, the all-seeing, all-powerful, all-wise, and other than that, from the names and attributes, this type is named Tawheed al-Asma'i wa-Sifat. Therefore, we have not exited from the Qur'an and Sunnah with our division of Tawheed into three sections. Because of that, the saying of the rejecter isn't begetting that the division of Tawheed into three sections is a new division with no origin. The answer is what you've heard, that the division is from al-istiqra, and the dalil of al-istiqra is accepted by the people of knowledge, and the ones that looks into these areas the most are the ulama of usul. This is the way the secret of tawheed is being in three sections becomes clear. If we understood the meaning of tawheed and the meaning of al-aqidah, what is the goal from studying al-aqidah and studying of tawheed? The goal of this is for the worshipper to know his Lord and his Creator and the guardian of his ni'mah. With what does the worshipper know his Lord? Does he see Him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not seen in this dunya, in this place. He isn't seen. With the meaning that seeing Him isn't impossible, but it's not going to happen. It hasn't happened and it's not going to happen. Because the strength of the human beings isn't able to hold up in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted it. Because of that, when Musa requested to see his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he connected this vision to him looking at the mountain. And if the mountain wasn't able to stay in its place and not become asunder or turn into powder or something like this, then Musa alayhi salam will see him. And if the mountain is not able to stay firm, then of course Musa would be the first one not being able to stay firm. And the mountain wasn't able to stay firm in front of the uncovering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here it becomes clear to Musa, even if the vision isn't impossible, and it's permissible or possible aql and thinking wise or shara'an legislatively, but it is not going to happen in this dunya because of the weakness of the human being. This in this place. And Musa accepted that.
وفي ليلة الإسراء والمعراج عندما نزل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعاد من تلكم الرحلة الطويلة القصيرة من حيث المسافة القصيرة من حيث عودة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في نفس الليلة إلى مكة فور عودته من الرحلة الطويلة سئل النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام هل رأيت ربك؟ قال نور أنا أرى حجابه النور إلى إذن على أصح القولين لم يرى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ربه في تلك الليلة بعين رأسه وإن رآه بقلبه بل أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في آخر قصة المسيح الدجال إنكم لن تروا ربكم حتى تموتوا فاعلموا بأنكم لن تروا ربكم حتى تموتوا بلن التي يقول فيها بعض علماء اللغة أنها تفيد التأبيد وأما في الآخرة فيرى العباد ربهم مرتين المرة الأولى في عرسات القيامة هذه الرؤية يختلف فيها أهل العلم هل هي خاصة بالمؤمنين أو يراه الكفار والمنافقون ثم يحتجب رب العالمين تأديبا لهم وتوبيخا لهم وإهانة لهم هذا رأي والرأي الثاني إنهم لن يروه وأما المرة الثانية في دار الكرامة في الجنة تلك رؤية خاصة بأولياء الله بالمؤمنين المؤمنون سوف يرون ربهم كما يرون القمر ليلة البدر وكما يرون الشمس ليس دونها سحاب رؤية حقيقية لا يضامون فيها ولا يتضررون من الزحام كل يرفع رأسه من موقعه فيرى ربه من فوقه فالله سبحانه وتعالى يسلم عليهم من فوقهم ويتجلى لهم فيخاطبهم سلام قولا من رب رحيم هكذا في تلك الدار وبعد إذا كنا لا نرى ربنا في هذه الدار بما نعرف ربنا نعرف الله سبحانه وتعالى بآياته التي تكاد أن تنطق بآياته الكونية الكون برمته آية على وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى وفي كل شيء آية تدل على أنه واحد في كل شيء آية تدل على أنه واحد قبل أن نؤمن بوحدانيته وقدرته وعلمه فلنؤمن بوجوده وجودك أنت دليل على وجود الله إذا كنت لا تشك في وجودك وهل أحد يشك في وجود نفسه لا يجوز عقلا وشرعا أن يشك في وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى أم خلقوا من غير شيء أم هم الخالقون من أين جئت أنت هل خلقت نفسك مستحيل هل خلقت من غير خالق مستحيل القسمة الثالثة لك خالق وذلك الخالق مخالف لك في كل شيء خالق قادر على كل شيء بدليل إبداعه لهذا الكون هذا الإبداع على غير مثال سابق فهو بديع السماوات والأرض وهذا الإبداع دال أول ما يدل على وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى وثانيا يدل على قدرته الباهرة إذن الخالق ليس كالمخلوق مخالف للمخلوق في حقيقة ذاته وكنه ذاته ولكنه لا يعلم كيف هو إلا هو، ويخالف المخلوق في قدرته، لأن قدرة المخلوق قدرة حادثة وجدت بعد أن لم تكن. الله الذي منعك هذه القدرة يجب أن تعلم أنه يتصف بقدرة أقوى من قدرتك، لأنه هو الذي منعك هذه القدرة. إذن هذا الإبداع وهذا الإيجاد وكونه فاطر السماوات والأرض دل على وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى وجودا حقيقيا، بحيث لا يجوز عقلا وشرعا وفطرة أن يشك أحد في وجود الرب إلا إذا كان يشك في وجود نفسه. الله موجود لأنك موجود، لأنك آية، لأنك علامة دالة على وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى. ثم إنه قادر على كل شيء وخالق كل شيء، دل ذلك على قدرته الباهرة، ودل التخصيص على إرادته وعلمه المحيط بكل شيء. معنى التخصيص أن يخص كل شيء وكل فرد على صفة وعلى حالة معينة. زيد عالم وعمر جاهل، بكر غني وخالد فقير، وهكذا. هذا التخصيص تخصيص العباد كلا بصفة وبحالة. هذا التخصيص دليل الإرادة ودليل العلم. علمه محيط بكل شيء. إذن نستدل بوجودنا وبصفاتنا وبخلق الرب سبحانه وتعالى وصنعه على وجود الرب سبحانه وتعالى، وعلى أنه موصوف بصفات الكمال. فصفات الرب كلها صفات كمال. هكذا نؤمن بالرب سبحانه وتعالى.
Of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came down and returned from the long trip, also the short trip. He said the long distance wise, the long trip being distance wise, and the short trip because of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's return in the same night to Mecca immediately after his long trip. He was asked, "Did you see your Lord?" He said, "Nurun." He said, "Nur, light is what I saw." His hijab was nur. His hijab, his covering, was light. Therefore, the most authentic of the two sayings is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not see his Lord with his two eyes. He saw him with his heart. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informs us in the story of the Dajjal. At the end of the story, he says, "Surely you all will not see your Lord until you all die. Know for certainty or for surety that you all will never see your Lord until you die." And he says with lan, which some of the ulama of lugha, some of the scholars of the language, they say it benefits at-ta'deed, at-ta'beed, excuse me, he said at-ta'beed, meaning abada, meaning never. As for in the hereafter, the worshipper sees his Lord twice. In this, the ulama have differences. Does the believer see him, or does the disbelievers and the munafiqun see him? Then the hijab is replaced, then the covering is replaced. As for some sort of discipline or disgrace for them, that is one opinion. The second opinion is that they will not see him. As for the second vision, this is only for the believers. The believers are the only ones that will see him with the second vision. The friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers will see their Lord the way they see the moon the night of Al-Badr, and they will see the sun without any clouds, the real vision. They are not bothered or affected by the crowd. Every one of them will lift up their heads and see his Lord above. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then will give the salams from above. He will become clear for them to see him. Then he will speak to them a saying from the most merciful, the Lord the Lord of all the heavens and earth. This is what goes on in that place. And after that, if we were not able to see our Lord in that place, with what would we know our Lord? We would know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His ayats, by the ayats of His creation, the ayat that shows the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High and Glorified. And in everything, there are ayats showing to the fact that He is one. In everything, there is an ayat showing that He is one before we believe in His oneship, His power, His knowledge. We first must believe in His existence. Your existence is a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's existence. And if you have any doubts in your existence, is there anyone who doubts in his existence, then it is not permissible or logically or legislatively to doubt the existence of your Lord the Most High. He said the ayat, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Are they created from nothing, or are they the creators? From where did you come? He asks. Did you create yourself? Impossible. Are you created without a creator? Impossible. He says Allah is the creator and the one who has power over everything. With the dalil that he started or created the cone of existence. This creation without any example from before. He is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this creation is an evidence showing the existence of your Lord. Existence of the Lord or of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High. And the second thing, it shows to expansive power. Therefore, the Creator isn't like or is the same as the creations. He is different from the creations in the reality of His essence, the completion of His essence. But no one knows that except Himself. He is different from the creation in His power. Because the power of the creation is something that happened. It's present after not being present. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who prevented you from this power. It's a must that you know that His description He's described with power greater than your power, because He is the one who prevented you from this power. Therefore, this creating an excellence and being the creator of the heavens and the earth shows to the fact that He is Allah, the Lord. He is present in reality from the standpoint that it's not permissible legislatively, logically, and the way of natural disposition for anyone to doubt in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord, except if he is doubting in the existence of Himself. Allah is present because you are present, because you are an ayat, because you are a sign showing the existence of your Lord, the Most High. Then He's the one that has power over everything, and the one who created everything, that shows His expansive power, and He and His takhsis shows His wanting, His knowledge encompasses everything. The meaning of takhsis, that everything or everyone has his or its own descriptions and its own condition. He used the example of Zaydun. Zayd is an alim, is a scholar, and Amr is jahil, that he's ignorant. He said Bakr is ghani, meaning he's rich, and Khalidun is faqir. And like this, he said this takhsis is takhsis al-ibadah, everything which is descriptions and its conditions. This takhsis is the dalil of his wanting and the dalil of His ilm, His knowledge. His knowledge encompasses everything. Therefore, we are able to use the evidence of our existence and our description, and with the descriptions, and with Allah's creation and His making of it, for Allah being present, and that His description with His complete attributes. So the descriptions of His Lord, all of them are complete. This is the way we believe in our Lord.
المادة التي سوف ندرسها تهدف إلى تعريف العباد ربهم هذا التعريف، ثم تهدف المادة إلى أن يعرف العباد حق الله على العباد وحق العباد على الله وحقوق رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام وحقوق الصالحين لئلا نخلق بين الحقوق كما هو واقع كثير من الناس. حق الله على عباده أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا. هذا الحق الذي اهتم به النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ذلكم الاهتمام حيث وجه السؤال إلى صحابي: يا معاذ، أتدري ما حق الله على العباد؟ هذا السؤال إنما ورد بهذه الصيغة، هذا التعليم إنما ورد بهذه الصيغة ليثير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم انتباه ذلك الصحابي لما يقول ولما يلقى إليه، وذلك دليل على أهمية هذا الحق. قال الصحابي: الله ورسوله أعلم. ثم بين رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حق الله على عباده أن يعبدوه ولا يشركوا به شيئا. هذا حق لازم، من ضيع هذا الحق أو صرف هذا الحق لغير الله فهو ظالم. الظلم الأكبر الشرك بالله. وهل تدري ما حق العباد على الله؟ حق العباد على الله ألا يعذب من لا يشرك به شيئا، ولكنه حق تفضل وإحسان ورحمة من الله. العباد لا يوجبون على الله حقا، وحق العباد على الله ليس بحق لازم بل حق تفضل وإحسان. هكذا اهتم النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ووجه ذلكم السؤال بكل عناية إلى ذلكم الصحابي. ومادتنا هذه تهدف إلى تعريف العباد هذا الحق والتفريق بين الحقين، بين حق الله على العباد وحق العباد على الله.
And that which we study, the goal is to know one's Lord, the Most High. This definition, then the worshipper knowing this, the right Allah has over his worshippers, the rights of Allah and the rights of the Messenger of Allah, the right of the Salihin, the righteous ones, that they do not mix up those rights like we find from a lot of people today. The right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over his worshippers, that they worship him and not associate any partners with him. This haq, this right, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave great importance to it, as he asked the question to the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. He said, O Mu'adh, do you know the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over his worshippers? And this question was asked to have an effect and in order for the Sahaba to pay attention to that which was asked or that which was said. And that is the dalil, showing the evidence, showing the importance of this right. The Sahaba, Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu, said, Allah and his messenger knows best. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarified this right. He said, to worship him and not associate with him anything with him. This is a mandatory right. Whoever has lost this right or changed the right for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a zalim, and this is meaning that he has committed shirk, the major shirk. And do you know the right of the worshipper over Allah? The right of the worshipper over Allah is not to punish any of them who does not associate with him anything or any partners. But this right is not a right. This right is a right of mercy and goodness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The worshipper cannot make a right wajib or mandatory on Allah. The right of the worshipper over Allah isn't haqqul lazim. It is not something that is a must. It's not a right that is mandatory, like we said before. It is not a mandatory right. It's a right of mercy and goodness. Like this, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave importance to the question with all carefulness to that sahaba. And this substance or constant, the contents of this this goal is for the worshipper to acknowledge the right and to separate between these two rights. The right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his worshippers or over his worshippers, and the right of the worshippers over Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وأما حقوق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يصدق ولا يكذب. رسول يجب أن يصدق ولا يكذب، فيطاع ولا يعصى، ولكنه عبد لا يعبد. هذه النقطة المهمة، عبد لا يعبد، عبد الله ورسوله، لكونه رسول الله يجب أن يطاع ويجب أن يصدق ويجب أن لا يعبد الله إلا بما جاء به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهو عبد حقق مقام العبودية ما لم يحققه غيره، لذلك لا يعبد، لا يدعى ولا يستغاث به ولا يذبح له ولا ينذر له، لا يتقرب إليه بأي نوع من أنواع العبادة، وذلك يتنافى مع هدف رسالته، الرسالة التي جاء بها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تهدف إلى إفراد الله تعالى بالعبادة وحده، لا أحد يستحق العبادة معه، لا ملك مقرب ولا نبي مرسل ولا عبد صالح. هذه الحقوق يجب أن تعرف ويجب أن توضع مواضعها. وأما عباد الله الصالحون وهم أولياء الله وهم جميع المؤمنين، لهم حقوق من حق العباد، من حقوق عباد الله الصالحين. على بعضهم ألا يؤذي بعضهم بعضا، من عادى لوليا فقد آدمتم بالحرب. إياك أن تؤذي عباد الله، وعليك أن تحبهم في الله، وإذا أحببتهم في الله ولله تخبرهم من السنة أنك تحبه في الله، تحبه في الله ولا تحبه مع الله. ولعلنا نفرق بين الحب في الله والحب مع الله. محبة أولياء في الله ولأجل الله ولكونهم عباد الله الصالحين وأولياءه المقربين العاملين بكتابه وبهدي نبيه عليه الصلاة والسلام شعبة من شعب الإيمان. وأما محبة الصالحين مع الله بحيث تجعلهم شركاء لله، ترجوهم كما ترجو رب العالمين، وتدعوهم مع الله أو من دون الله، وتتقرب إليهم بالقربات، هذا من نوع الشرك الأكبر. فرق بين المحبتين، بينهما بون شاسع. المحبة الأولى عبادة عظيمة وقربة، المحبة الثانية شرك بالله. هذه المعاني من المعاني التي تهدف إليها مادتنا التي نريد أن ندرسها. إذن التوحيد الذي نريد أن ندرسه والعقيدة التي نريد أن ندرسها، هذا موضوعها، ما ذكرناه الآن موضوع عقيدتنا وتوحيدنا، وهو توحيد الأنبياء.
As for the rights concerning the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is to be taken as truthful and not as a liar. So he is obeyed and not disobeyed, but he is a slave not to be worshipped, this is an important point, a slave not to be worshipped, a slave servant of Allah and His Messenger. Because of him being the Messenger of Allah, he has to be obeyed. It is a must that he is taken as truthful, and it's a must that he is not worshipped, except with that which, meaning that Allah is not worshipped, except with that that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. He is a slave servant who has reached the level of high worship, which no one other than him has ever reached. Because of that, he is not worshipped. He is not to be called upon, and he is not to seek. There is no deliverance from him or seeking any rescue from him, and he is not sacrificed for, and he is not to be vowed to, and you do not come close to him with any type of worship. And that, because that goes against the goal or the goal that of his risala, of his message in which he came with. Its goal is singling Allah out with his worship for him alone. No one deserves to be worshipped along with him. He said no prophet that was sent, and no, there's no angel that was brought close, nor a righteous worshipper. These right, it's a must that its place is known. It's a must that we put it in the right place. As for the righteous worshippers, they are friends of Allah. They are all the believers. They're all of the believers. They have rights. From their rights, the rights of the righteous ones upon each other is that the rights of the righteous ones upon each other is that they do not bother each other or make each other vexed. He said, "Man adha li waliyan faqad adantu bil harb." That whoever vexes or bothers me from a friend of mine, then I have made permissible for him war, meaning against him. He said, "I warn you against vexing the worshippers of Allah. It's mandatory that you love them for Allah. And if you love them for Allah because of Allah, tell him it's from the sunnah that you love him for Allah. You love him for Allah and not with Allah." He said, I hope we're able to separate between those two loves, for Allah and not a love with Allah. He says here, loving the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of Allah, because of them being righteous worshippers and friends of Allah. Those that work with the book of Allah and the guidance of his messenger, of his prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is a branch from the branches of iman. He said, as for loving the righteous people with Allah to the point that you make them partners with Allah, having hope in them the way you would have hope in the Lord of the heavens and the earth, or calling upon them with Allah or besides Allah, or getting close to them with these things which bring you close. And this is from the major type of shirk. Make a difference between the two worships. Between both of them is a great difference. The first worship is a great worship and closeness. The second worship is shirk, is associating partners with Allah. These meanings are the goal in which we are trying to study. Therefore, the tawheed in which we wanted to study and the aqidah which we wanted to study, this is its subject. And what we mentioned now, the subject of our belief is the subject of our belief and our tawheed, and it is the tawheed of the anbiya.
توحيد على منهج الأنبياء وأنبياء الله توحيدهم واحد دعوتهم واحدة كلهم دعوا إلى إفراد الله تعالى بالعبادة. وبعد أن دخل علم الكلام في الميدان وكثرت الأهواء ألف علماء أهل السنة والجماعة كتبا في هذا التوحيد وفي هذه العقيدة. ومن الكتب التي ألفت في هذه العقيدة رسالة صغيرة تسمى العقيدة الواسطية. هذه العقيدة أو هذا الكتيب عبارة عن جواب كتبه شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية جوابا على رسالة وردته من واسط بالشام، يسألون في رسالتهم عن عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة، فأجاب الشيخ على السؤال بهذا الكتاب. وهذا شأن أكثر رسائل شيخ الإسلام، الفتوى الحموية جواب لرسالة وردته من حماء، والرسالة التدمرية كذلك، وهذه الواسطية. ثم إن هذه الرسالة التي نحن بصددها شرحها عالم أزهري سلفي، عالم تخرج من الأزهر وتخصص في الفلسفة والمنطق، وكان يؤادي شيخ الإسلام عداء كما كان يؤادي عمر رضي الله عنه الإسلام في أول الأمر. كان الشيخ محمد خليل هراس الذي شرح هذه الرسالة يعادي ابن تيمية عداء لما يسمع منه أنه عدو للفلسفة والمنطق، ومحمد خليل هراس متخصص في الفلسفة والمنطق. لذلك أراد كما أشار إليه بعض الناس أن يكتب رسالة الدكتوراه ردا على شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية الذي يعادي الفلسفة والمنطق وعلم الكلام. ويقول الشيخ محمد خليل هراس كان أستاذا لنا، روى لنا هذه الرواية شفهيا مباشرة، يقول جمع له ما وقعت عليه يده من كتب شيخ الإسلام في القاهرة ليدرسها ثم يرد على شيخ الإسلام، فعكف على دراسة هذه الكتب نحو 3 أشهر. ويقول الشيخ محمد خليل هراس الذي شرح الواسطية بعد أن درس ما تيسر له دراسته من كتب شيخ الإسلام في هذه الفترة تبين له أنه لم يفهم الإسلام بعد إلا بعد دراسة هذه الكتب. ذلك العمر الطويل والدراسة الكثيرة بدءا من المرحلة الابتدائية ثم المتوسطة ثم الثانوية ثم الجامعية إلى أن وصل إلى درجة كتابة رسالة الدكتوراه، تبين له أنه لم يفهم الإسلام بالمفهوم الصحيح قبل دراسة هذه الكتب. هكذا هدى الله رجلا كان يريد أن يحارب شيخ الإسلام، فكتب رسالته في الدكتوراه تحت عنوان ابن تيمية السلفي، هذا عنوان رسالته بعد أن من الله عليه بالهداية. هذا هو محمد خليل هراس الذي شرح العقيدة الواسطية. أما ترجمة شيخ الإسلام فلسنا بحاجة إليها، لأنه معروف لدى الجميع وترجم له غير واحد، وعلى طلاب العلم أن يدرسوا تراجم علمائنا وأئمتنا كالأئمة الأربعة وابن تيمية وابن القيم وغيرهم من الذين ينهجون منهج السلف حتى يكونوا على بصيرة، وحتى لا يشوش عليهم بعض المغرضين بأن يقولوا لهم هذه العقيدة التي تدرسونها عقيدة جديدة. وفي الواقع القائلون بأن منهج السلف وهذه العقيدة التي ندرسها ما هو الجديد، بيان ذلك العقيدة التي ندرسها هي التي كان عليها الصحابة والتابعون وتابع التابعين بما في ذلكم الأئمة الأربعة. وهذه العقيدة التي يدرسها الخلف وأتباع الخلف التي تسمى العقيدة الأشعرية متى عرفت؟ عرفت في العهد العباسي، أمس في العهد العباسي وقبل العهد العباسي على أي عقيدة كان المسلمون. الصحابة وخلفاء الأمويين وخلفاء العباسيين إلى عهد المأمون العباسي الخليفة السابع قبل ذلك لا يعرفون هذه العقيدة التي تسمى الآن العقيدة الأشعرية. إذن ما عليه القوم سواء كانوا أشعريين أو ماتريديين أو معتزلة عقيدة مهدثة لا أصل لها ولا يعرفها سلف هذه الأمة. وكل خير باتباع من سلف وكل شر باتباع من خلف.
توحيد and the manhaj of the Anbiya of Allah, the توحيد is one. All of them call to singling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with ibadah, with worship. And it was after the entrance of knowledge of kalam, and it was after the entrance of knowledge of kalam into the affairs of deen, and desires became plentiful. The ulama of Ahlu Sunnah wa Jama'ah wrote books in this tawheed and in this aqeedah. And from books written in aqeedah, we have a small book named Al-Aqeedah Al-Wasitiyah. This aqeedah or this book is a consideration regarding an answer by Shaykh al-Islam from a letter which reached them from Wasit, and this is in Sham. They are asking in their letter about the aqeedah of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. So the Shaykh concerning the answer to the question which this book, and this is the condition of most of the books of Shaykh al-Islam in Taymiyyah, such as Fatawa al-Hamawiyyah. This is an answer for the letter which reached him from Hamad, and the book Tadmariyyah also, and this Wasitiyyah. Then this book al-Wasitiyyah, that we have it, was explained by an alim, a scholar, Azhari, meaning he graduated from Azhar in Egypt. Salafi, a scholar, graduated from Al-Azhar, and he specialized in philosophy and debate, and he used to be an enemy to Shaykh al-Islam, the way Umar was an enemy to Islam before, at the beginning of Islam. He said, here, this man that we're talking about was enemy to Shaykh al-Islam. His name is Shaykh Muhammad Khalil Harras, the one who explained the book Al-Aqeedah Al-Wasitiyyah. He said he was an enemy to Shaykh al-Islam. At first, he wrote the explanation as a refutation because he heard that Shaykh al-Islam was an enemy to philosophy and debate. He said, and Muhammad Khalil Harras specialized in philosophy and debate. Because of that, some of the people pointed to the fact that he wanted to write his Risala as a doctorate to refute Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, the one who is an enemy to philosophy, debate, and knowledge of Kalam. And Shaykh Muhammad Khalil Harras, he was a teacher to us. He reported to us these narrations directly from his lips. He said he would gather from what his hands found from the books of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and Cairo to study it, then refute Shaykh al-Islam. So he studied the books of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala 3 months. So Muhammad Khalil Harras says, and he is the one who explained the book Al-Aqeedah Al-Wasitiyyah. After studying this book for that time, it became clear to him that he really doesn't understand Islam yet, except he haven't really understood Islam except after studying those books of Shaykh al-Islam that long time and those many classes from the beginning stages, at the elementary stage, then the middle school stage, then high school, then university, till he reached the stage of writing a book. Until he reached a stage of writing a book for his doctrine, it became clear to him that he hasn't really understood Islam to its fullest, to its clarity. He hasn't understood Islam correctly. It wasn't until after studying the books of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. He said, this way Allah guided this man who wanted to wage war upon Shaykh al-Islam. After that,
he wrote his doctrine under the title, he said, Ibn Taymiyyah As-Salafi, after Allah gave him guidance. This is the title of the book, after being guided by Allah. This is Muhammad Khalil Harras, being guided by Allah. This is Muhammad Khalil Harras. He is the one who explained Al-Aqidah Al-Wasitiyah. As for the biography of Shaykh al-Islam, we are not in the need of it right now because it is known by all of us. And more than one person have done the biography of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Also, it's upon the students of knowledge, this is the advice from the Shaykh, it's upon the students of knowledge to study the biographies of our scholars and imams, as the four imams, and Ibn Taymiyyah, or Ibn Qayyim, and other than them, from those who follow the manhaj of the Salaf, to be upon knowledge, and in order that no one from the people of deviation could come and cause any kind of disturbance by saying this aqidah, which you all are studying, is a new aqidah. And they are actually right now, there are people saying this. There are people saying that the manhaj of the Salaf and this aqidah which we are studying is a new aqidah. They're wrong. What you're upon is new. The evidence of that, the aqidah that we are studying, the sahabas, the tabi'un, and the followers of the tabi'un were upon that. And also from that of the four imams, this aqidah that in which the khulafa, in which the people that came after these people and those people that followed those people who came after those people, the aqidah in which is called al-aqidah al-ash'ariyah. When was it known? It was known in the time of Abbasi, and before that time of Abbasi, on what aqidah were the Muslims upon? The Sahabas and the Khulafa of al-Amwiyyin and the people of Abbasi. The Khulafa of Abbasi, to the time of the people which were led by Abbasi, the seventh Khalifa. Before that, they did not know the Aqidah which is now known as Aqidah al-Ash'ariyah. Therefore, the people are upon this Aqidah with the people upon its Ash'ariyah. Whether it's Ash'ariyah or Maturidiyah or Mu'tazilah, or an innovative aqidah. No origin, he says. This is an innovative aqidah. There's no origin for it. And the Salaf of this Ummah didn't know it. And every good is in following the Salaf. And every evil is an innovation of the Khalaf.
كلما يتدين به الإنسان ويتدلل له ويتعبد به فهو دين. ما كانت عليه قريش يسمى دينا، دين الجاهلية، دين العرب، دين المشركين. وما عليه الهندوك والبوذيون دين أرضي. وكل من عدا الماركسيين الشيوعيين ومن عدا العلمانيين كلهم يدينون بدين. التدين بالدين طبيعة في البشر، سواء كان هذا التدين حقا أو باطلا، إلا من ارتد بعد أن تفسد فطرته، لأن الله فطر العباد على التوحيد، فطرة الله التي فطر الناس عليها. الإنسان مفطور على التوحيد، بمعنى لو أن مولودا ما ولد فترك في مكان بعيد عن المؤثرات الخارجية فينشأ على التوحيد، لا يعرف شركا ولا كفرا ولا انحرافا ولا إلحادا. كل مولود يولد على الفطرة، إلا أن أبواه يهودان أو ينصران أو يمجدان. الأصل التوحيد، كل مولود مفطور على التوحيد ومجبول على توحيد الله. ما لم يقرأ بالمؤثرات الخارجية شيء جديد، إلحاد وانحراف وكفر وشرك. هذه الملة التي ينادي بها بعض المنحرفين ملة الإلحاد وإنكار وجود الله وإنكار دين الله، ملة جاءت من الانحراف، قوم أثرت فيهم البيئة التي نشأوا فيها والمؤثرات الخارجية حتى خرجوا على الطبيعة. وإلا لو وجهنا سؤالا إلى بدوي في أعماق البادية لم يتصل بأحد قط إلا بمواشيه، لو وجهنا إليه سؤالا هل تعرف ربك؟ يقول نعم. لو قلت له أين الله؟ لا يتردد أن يقول الله. لذلك إذا ضلت ناقته ماذا يقول؟ يا رب ردها علي يا رب، يرفع يديه. من أين تعلم؟ من الفطرة. دليل ذلك سؤال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الجارية العجمية التي كانت ترعى غنم أهلها، التي غضب عليها مولاها ذات مرة في سبب من الأسباب لا داعي لشرعها ليطول، لقمها ثم ندم على لقمها لأنه لقمها في وجهها. اللقم في الوجه ممنوع شرعا. إذا ضرب أحدكم غلاما فلا يضرب الوجه ولا يقبحه، لأن الله خلق آدم على صورته، خالف هذا النص فلقمها ثم ندم. فجاء إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يستشيره في عتقها، فأراد النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أن يعرف إيمانها من كفرها، فدعاها فحضرت بين يدي النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام، فاختبرها بسؤالين اثنين. السؤال الأول أين الله؟ ولم تتردد الجارية الجاهلة التي بقيت على فطرتها في أن تقول في السماء. والأشاعرة الذين يستصعبون هذه الإشارة والإيمان بالعلو حكموا على الجارية بأنها مجنونة، لكن على جنونها قالوا أشارت بيدها ولم تقل في السماء لأنها أعجمية، فلتكن أعجمية لم تقل بلسانها، ولكن هل توافقون بأنها أشارت؟ يكفي. السؤال الثاني من أنا؟ قالت أنت رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام. النتيجة اعتقها فإنها مؤمنة.
The thing which a person he practices religion with, he has humility with it and worship with it, that is deen, that is religion. What the tribe of Quraysh was upon is called deen, the deen of Jahiliyyah, the deen of the Arab, the deen of the Mushrikeen. And what the Hindus and Buddhas are upon is deen, deenul ardi. This means the deen of from this earth. It wasn't legislated. And everything besides the Markaziyin and Shuyu'in and besides the Almaniyin, all of them are deen. Practicing of deen is a natural disposition of the human being. Whether the deen is haq or falsehood, he says, except for the one who apostates, refusing his natural disposition. He says, Allah, because Allah created the worshippers upon Tawheed, the disposition in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them upon a person, then a person's disposition is upon Tawheed, with the meaning, if a person, when he's born and he's left in a far place from all of the things of influence from the outside, he's going to be upon what? Tawheed. Not known shirk, not known kufr, not known deviation, not known ilhad. Everyone is born upon the fitrah, the natural disposition, except that his two parents make him a Jew or a Christian or fire worshipper. The origin is Tawheed. Everyone is born upon Tawheed and on the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as he doesn't read anything from the outside influence, from shirk, from kufr, from ilhad, from deviation, these millas in which the people of deviation calls to the deen or the way of ilhad, denying Allah's presence and denying the deen of Allah, the millah which came from the deviation, of people who were influenced by the environment in which they came up and outside influence until they left out of the natural disposition. Except that if we were to ask the question to the Bedouin, this question to the Bedouin in the farthest part of the desert, he who has never met with anyone except animals, if we ask him, do you know your Lord? He will say yes. If you said to him, where is Allah? He is not one who would be back and forth. He's not one that would be back and forth. He would say Allah. Because of that, if he was to lose his camel, he would say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the heavens. If he were to lose his camel, he would say, oh my Lord, return her back to me, while raising his hands. From where did he learn this? From the natural disposition. The evidence of that is the question which the slave girl was asked by the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That slave girl who took care of the shepherd, the one which her master got mad at her that time for a reason from the different reasons, which there is no need to explain. He slapped her, then he became regretful, because he slapped her in her face, and hitting someone in their face is legislatively not permissible. If one of you hits a child, he is not to hit him in the face, and he is not to rebuke him, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam on his image, not Allah's image. The image of the shepherd girl went against the master of the shepherd girl went against the Nusus, the evidence, then regretted that. So he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam seeking some sort of guidance in freeing her. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wanted to know her belief from her disbelief. So he called her, and she came in front of the Prophet. So he tested her with two questions. The first is, where is Allah? And there was no back and forth in regarding this ignorant slave girl who stayed on her natural disposition from saying in the heavens. And those Ash'a'ira, those who disbelieve or deny this ishara, and the belief in the loftiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, made a ruling on the shepherd girl that she is crazy. But with her being crazy, they said she pointed with her hand, and she didn't say in the heavens, because she's a'jamiya. She didn't speak Arabiya. So let her be a'jamiya. But do you all agree that she pointed? Then that's enough. The second question, who am I? This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying this. She said, you are Rasulullah. The result is that he said, free her because she is a believer.
أريد أن أقول دليل الفطرة قبل أن يفسد يدرك الإنسان بدليل الفطرة وجود الله ويدرك بأن الله في العلو وأنه يدعى من فوق لا تجد عربيا أو عجميا متعلما أو غير متعلم إلا وهو يقول يا رب فإذا عرضت إذا نزلت نازلة بإنسان يلتفت قلبه إلى العلو قبل أن يرفع يديه لا يمكن أن يلتفت يمنة أو يسرى هذا دليل الفطرة دليل الفطرة ودليل العقل والحس وأخذ الميثاق على العباد وهم في صلب آدم كل ذلك مجتمعا يشهد بأن الله موجود وأنه في العلو وأنه وحده هو المعبود ولكن هنا سؤال: هل تكفي هذه الأدلة لإقامة الحجة على العباد؟ الجواب لا. لو كان دليل العقل ودليل الفطرة وأخذ العهد والميثاق على العباد، لو كانت هذه المعاني وهذه الأدلة كافية لإقامة الحجة على العباد لما أرسل الله الرسل وأنزل الكتب. إذن هذه الأدلة عبارة عن تمهيد للفهم الصحيح العام وللمعرفة الصحيحة العامة ولتحقيق التوحيد بعد أن يرسل الله الرسل وأنزل الكتب. لا إله إلا الله كلمة التوحيد، كلمة الإسلام، كلمة الإيمان، أصل الدين وأصل الإيمان وأصل الإسلام. ولكن الشأن، كل الشأن أن تفهم هذه الكلمة. كل من ينتسب إلى الإسلام يقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، ولكنها لا تمنعهم من دعوة غير الله ومن الاستغاثة بغير الله ومن الذبح لغير الله، بل من السجود لعتبة الشيخ. قد يجلس في المسجد بعد الصلاة ويذكر الله بلا إله إلا الله 100 مرة، فإذا خرج يريد أن يودع الشيخ يسجد على عتبة الشيخ سجودا، يضع جبهته على العتبة مودعا للشيخ. فإذا قلت له يقول لا، هذه مش عبادة، دي محبة الصالحين. أنتم ما تفهموا، هذه محبة الصالحين. لو كان يفهم معنى لا إله إلا الله لما خضع وتذلل لغير الله، لأن معنى العبادة عند عوام المسلمين الصلاة والزكاة والصيام والحج وكفى. ولكن حقيقة العبادة غاية الذل مع غاية الحب. من تذلل لغير الله كما يتذلل العبد لربه، وخضع وأحب غير الله كما يحب الموحد ربه، العبد. غاية الحب مع غاية الذل. لذلك يعتبر السجود من أعظم أنواع العبادة، لأنك في السجود حققت عبودية لا تحققها بغير السجود. عندما تضع جبهتك أشرف عضو في جسمك تضعها موضع رجلك على الأرض تذللا لله، لاحظ ماذا يقول الإنسان في سجوده؟ يقول سبحان ربي الأعلى، لئلا يخطر بقلبه خاطر شيطاني، إنما سجدت لله لأن الله تهدى. نفيا لهذه التهمة ولهذا الوهم شرع أن يقول العبد سبحان ربي الأعلى. يقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه وهو ساجد، قربا معنويا أقرب ما يكون العبد من ربه وهو ساجد. فليكثر من الدعاء فقمن أن يستجاب له، لأنه حقق العبودية تذلل لربه. ومن صرف هذا النوع لغير الله ناقض فعله قوله. لا إله إلا الله لها شروط، لا تكفي الكلمة الجوفاء، يجب أن تعلم شروطها: العلم واليقين والإخلاص والصدق والمحبة والقبول والانقياد. يجب أن تتوافر هذه الشروط في لا إله إلا الله، وبدون علم وبدون أن تكون على يقين بأنه لا معبود بحق إلا الله، وقبل أن تكون صادقا مع الله، ودون أن تخلص لله العبادة وتقبل ما دلت عليه هذه الكلمة وتنقاد لمقتضاها، لا تنفعك هذه الكلمة الجوفاء. لذلك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله كلمة عظيمة يجب أن تفهم كما فهمها من قبلنا وأتلزوا بها وبالله التوفيق.
I want to say the دليل, the evidence of the natural disposition before being corrupted, the person knows the evidence of the fitra, the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he knows that Allah is in the ulu, and he is called upon, and he is above. He mean he is called upon while the person is known that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above. You will not find an Arab, or non-Arab, educated or non-educated, except that he says, "Oh Lord," and if someone has some sort of problem, the person's heart turns to the Creator before raising his hands. It's not possible to turn right or left. This is dalil of the fitrah and dalil of common sense. The best trust upon the worshipper, and they are in the loins of Bani Adam. So he testifies that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is present, and he's high, lofty, and he is the one, he's the only one to be worshipped. But here we have a question. All of these evidences, are they enough to establish the hujjah upon the worshippers? The answer is no. If the dalil of common sense, or the dalil of natural disposition, or the taking of the trust upon the worshippers, if these meanings were enough to establish the hujjah upon the worshippers, Allah would have not sent the messengers, and He would have not sent down the books. Therefore, these evidences are considered to be a beginning for a general understanding, and also for a sound general understanding, and also for the tahqiq al-tawheed. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent His messengers and sent down His books. La ilaha illallah, a word of tawheed, a word of Islam, a word of iman, the origin of deen, the origin of iman, the origin of Islam. But what's important is that we understand these words. Everyone who affiliates himself to Islam says ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. He says, I testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that doesn't stop him from calling on other than Allah. They have istighatha for other than Allah, slaughtering for other than Allah, even to the point of prostrating to the doorstep of their sheikhs, and it's possible that he's a person who sits in the masjid remembering Allah with La ilaha illallah 100 times if he wanted to humble himself. But if he wanted to humble himself to the sheikh, he would prostrate at the doorstep of the sheikh. If you said something to him, he would say, "No, this is not worship. You all don't understand. This is admiration for the righteous people. You all don't understand," he would say. If he understood the meaning of La ilaha illallah, he would not have khudu' for Allah other than Allah. He wouldn't have khudu' for other than Allah. And he wouldn't have tazallu for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the meaning of worship with most of the Muslims, unfortunately, is as-salah, the prayer, as-zakat, the giving of the charity, as-sayam, the fasting, al-hajj, and that's enough. But the reality of worship is غَيْتَ الظُّلْ مَعْ غَيْتَ الْحُبْ. That he said the reality of worship is the ultimate humility, or the ultimate humbleness, along with the ultimate love. Whoever has tadallul for other than Allah, the way the worshipper would have tadallul for Allah, or khudu', and loves other than Allah, the way the muwahid, the person who worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, loves his Lord, surely he has worshipped. He has worshipped. He says, غَايَةُ الْحُبْ مَعْ غَايَةِ الذِّلْ. He said, because of that, sujood is considered to be from the greatest type of worship. Because in sujood, this is tahakkuk. He said this is tahqiq. He said this is tahqiq for ubudiyyah, for the high level of worship. He said there is no tahqiq for it, except if there's no tahqiq for it, there's no truity of it, except with sujood. He said when you place your forehead, the most noble part of your body, you place it at the place where we put our feet, on the ground, with humility for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of that, what does a person say in his sujood? He says, Subhana Rabbil A'la. He says, Subhana Rabbil A'la. He said, glory to you, or glory to my Lord, the Most High. In order, and he says, he makes a point here, in order that nothing shaitanic gets into a person's heart, he doesn't get any faults, or get misled by shaitan. And shaitan comes to him and says, surely, you prostrated for Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah is beneath you. This is an incorrect statement. And in order to refute this accusation, or this delusion, it was legislated for the Abu to say, subhanahu rabbil a'la, glory to my Lord the Most High. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the closest that the Abd is to his Lord is when he's in sujood. He said this closeness is figuratively. So make abundance of dua, perchance that it would be answered, because he has reached the level of ubudiyyah, of high worship. He said at-tadallul for his Lord, and whoever changes this type for except than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then in his saying, La ilaha illallah, and he says also, his saying, La ilaha illallah has shurut. Don't just let it be dry words, hard enough. Don't just let it be La ilaha illallah, and you're doing shirk, or so forth like that. It's a must that you know it's shurut. There's conditions to the meaning of La ilaha illallah. He says, Al-ilm, knowledge. He says, Al-yaqeen, certainty. He says, Al-ikhlas, sincerity. He says, Al-sidq. He says, truthfulness. He says, Al-muhabba. He says, love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Al-qubool. He says, Al-qubool, acceptance. And he said, Al-qiyad, submission. It's a must that these shuruts, that they are enacted in the meaning of La ilaha illallah. These shurut, they must be enacted in the meaning of La ilaha illallah, and before and without knowledge, and before being upon yaqeen, there is none to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and before being truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make the worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make this in abundance, and accept what these words indicate, or what this word indicates.
الزمن انتهى ولكن أجيب على سؤال مهم وأجيب. وهذا السؤال بالنسبة لي ليس لغريب. قد سئلت مثل هذا السؤال عدة مرات. شبابنا على مفترق الطرق وتحت التشويش. المؤثرات كثيرة والمشوشون كثيرون. والسؤال يقول: تدريس العقيدة بحجة أنها وهنالك من الدعاة المنتسبين إلى الدعوة يشككون في تدريس العقيدة بحجة أنها تسبب تعييرا تهجيرا للعقل، وأنها تفرق بين المسلمين، وأن الأمة الإسلامية بحاجة إلى جمع الشمل لمواجهة الأعداء ونحو ذلك. كلمات معصولة. العقيدة الإسلامية تفرق؟ نعم إنها تفرق. جاء رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليفرق، هكذا في الحديث، جاء محمد ليفرق، والقرآن يفرق، والإسلام يفرق. الذي لا يرضى هذا التفريق ويريد أن يكون الناس مجتمعين غير متفرقين، معنى ذلك هو علماني. العلمانيون الذين كفروا بالأديان كلها يريد أن يجتمعوا تحت الإنسانية. وأما هذه الكلمة الجميلة التي جاء بها إن الأمة الإسلامية بحاجة إلى جمع شمل، إلى جمع الشمل لمواجهة الأعداء، بأي شيء تواجه الأعداء؟ إذا كنت لا تدرس العقيدة ولا تحقق العقيدة ولا تعرف العقيدة تكتفي من الإسلام بمجرد انتساب. ما ديانته؟ الإسلام. في شهادة الميلاد مكتوب مسلم، تكتفي بهذا الإسلام وبهذا تجمع شمل المسلمين، شمل الأمة. لا يمكن جمع شتات المسلمين إلا بالعقيدة. فرقت العقيدة أول ما فرقت بين الناس إلى أولياء الله تعالى إلى أعداء الله، أولياء الله وأعداء الله. والناس بين حزبين، حزب الله وحزب الشيطان. وأما من يحاول، لا يؤمر بالمعروف ولا ينهى عن المنكر، لا يقال هذا شرك وهذا توحيد، هذه سنة وهذه بدعة، وأن هذا الأسلوب يفرق، ولكن نريد أن نجمع المسلمين تحت الإسلام. الإسلام كيفما كان، علمانيا، رافضيا، شيوعيا، بعثيا، سنيا، مبتدعا، قال ما يدخل تحت اسم الإسلام يكفينا. من يريد أن يفهم الإسلام بهذا المفهوم فهو بحاجة إلى أن يدرس الإسلام من جديد، لم يفهم الإسلام. وهذا ليس جمع كلمة المسلمين، وهذا قضاء على الإسلام. الإسلام دين عمل. أولا العقيدة، معرفة حق الله على العباد كما سمعتم. وأقول ما قدمته من المقدمة في هذه الليلة يكفي جوابا على هذا السؤال بالنسبة للمنصف الذي يريد أن يفهم. أما من في نفسه هوى يريد أن ينتمي إلى جماعة معينة، وهذه الانتماءات الكثيرة تشوش عليها العقيدة، دراسة العقيدة تشوش على رواة المنتمين الذين يرغبون الانتماءات الكثيرة إلى الجماعة الفلانية، إلى زيد، إلى عمرو، إلى خالد. لا يريدون أن يكتفوا بنسبة واحدة الإسلام، ولا يريد أن يكتفوا بإمام واحد محمد رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام، بل يريدون أئمة، يريدون أمراء، يريدون زعماء يدينون لهم. فإذا ما جاءت العقيدة وجمعت الناس عبروا بالتعبير المعاكس، فرقت. هذا الأسلوب لا ينبغي أن ينقل على شبابنا. ادرسوا عقيدتكم بهذه العقيدة تحصل العزة والمناعة للأمة، وبترك العقيدة يحصل الضعف والتفرق والتشتت. عليكم بالعقيدة ولا تسمعوا لمثل هذا الأسلوب. أقول مرة ثالثة، راجعوا ما ذكرنا في المقدمة وفي ذلك الكفاية، وبالله التوفيق.
I'm going to answer the important questions even though the time is up. And this question, as from where I'm concerned, is not strange to me. Surely I've been asked this question a lot of times. Our youth are on different ways and are under confusion. The influences are plenty and the people of confusion, disturbance, are plentiful. The studying of al-aqidah with the evidences of it, because there are some of the du'at to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I mean those callers to Allah, who have doubts in teaching al-aqidah, believing that it causes expulsion to the aql, to the senses, and it divides the Muslims. And in these times, we are at a need, we have an urgent need to fight our enemies. And other than that, these words are erroneously put. The answer to this question, as the Sheikh will go on to say, al-aqidah of Islam divides? Yes, it divides. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to divide, like this in the hadith.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to divide. The Quran divides and Islam divides. The one who is not happy with this division and they want all of the people to be together, not divided, the meaning of this is he's Al-Mani. He says, Al-Almaniyun, those who disbelieve in all religions, they want to gather under the banner of insan, people. And as for these beautiful words which he came with in the question, meaning the questioner, the Muslims are in an urgent need or have an urgent need for fighting our enemies. He says, with what will you fight our enemies? If you do not, with what will we fight our enemies if you do not study Tawheed and actualize Al-Aqeedah? And you do not know your Aqeedah. You're satisfied with just affiliating yourself to Islam. Or on your birth certificate it's written Muslim. You're satisfied with that as Islam. And this is what we'll gather the Ummah with. So it's impossible for the Ummah to gather except upon Aqeedah. Al-Aqeedah is the first thing which divided the people. Divided them into friends of Allah and enemies of Allah. And the people are of two types. Hizbullah, as we said before, the group of Allah. Or Hizbul Shaitan, the group of Shaitan. As for the one who tries not to command the good or forbid the evil. He doesn't say this is shirk and this is tawheed. This is sunnah. This is bid'ah. And that is the way it divides. But we want to gather the Muslims under Islam. Islam, however it may be, Ilmani, Rafidi, Shi'i, Ba'athi, Sunni, Mubtadi', everything under Islam is enough for us. Whoever wants to understand Islam with this understanding, he needs to go back and study Islam all over again. And this is not the gathering of the words, this is not gathering the words of the Muslim. This is annihilation of Islam. Islam is the deen of amal. First, al-aqeedah, the abd, he has to know what is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over his worshippers, which you heard before. And I will say that that which I started this talk with tonight is enough as an answer for the question with relation to the one that is just and he really has good need and he wants to understand. As for the one who has with him in himself hawa, desires, he wants to lean to be from a specific group, from a jama'ah. These intima'at are many. This leaning to these different groups. And the studying of Al-Aqeedah, it causes problem for these people. Those who wishes to go to these groups, go to so-and-so group, go to Zayd's group, or Khalid's group, or Amr's group, they do not want to be satisfied with one nisbah, Islam, and they do not want to be satisfied with one imam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They want imams, they want umara, they want a lot of people in charge, showing them their deen. And when Al-Aqeedah comes and brings the people together, they use words to describe it, which gives it the opposite meaning. They say farraqat, they say it divided. This way of talking is not necessary, and it shouldn't be a way that our youth are aware of. He says, study your aqeedah. With this aqeedah, the result would be izzah, and it will be invincibility for the ummah. And leaving off al-aqeedah comes weakness, comes division, comes separation. He said, alaykum bil-aqeedah. He said, I tell you that you should be upon aqeedah, you should study aqeedah. And do not allow the likes of these conduct. Do not allow this usloob. I will say for the third time, go back to what I said in the beginning. With that is enough, and the tawfiq is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah grant the brothers good and give them good on their skills. And may Allah grant the Shaykh Muhammad Amman, rahimahullah ta'ala, Jannah. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.